Inside the Magic, show number 400 for December 2nd, 2012. It is Sunday, December 2nd, 2012, and this is Big Show 400 of Inside the Magic. As always, I am your host, Ricky Briganti, and it's great to be reaching this big milestone, 400 episodes, but we have so much more to talk about this week than just celebrating our own milestone of episodes. There's a lot of really exciting things going on in the world of Disney, so before we get to all of that, I invite you to visit InsideTheMagic.net. There you'll find all of our podcasts, videos, photos, news articles, and plenty more, and if you ever have any news, tips, questions, comments, anything else you want to send in, you can email me at ricky@insidethemagic.net, or you can call and leave a message at 407-494-4ITM. That's 4486, and now, let's get on with the show. This week's episode of Inside the Magic is brought to you by Magical Travel. Travel the world with Disney. Experience hassle-free first-class service with an Adventures by Disney vacation, and you can receive up to a $600 Visa gift card when you book an Adventures by Disney vacation with Magical Travel. So call them today at 866-207-8387 or visit them online at magicaltravel.com and receive a free price quote. And be sure to mention Inside the Magic to receive your free Disney gift card for qualifying bookings when you book your Disney vacation with Magical Travel. And of course, thanks very much to listeners and viewers like you for your donations, one-time, recurring, or anybody clicking through InsideTheMagic.net/Amazon when doing a little holiday shopping this time of year through Amazon, of course. If you click through that first, we'll get a little bit of credit for your purchases. So thanks very much for all of that. And now, let's get started with a trip around the world. So we are celebrating 400 episodes of Inside the Magic this week, not in a huge way. If you've been tuning into the show for 400 episodes now, you'll know that back in show 100 and 200 and 300, we had some pretty big celebrations. We had Inside the Magic The Ride, I believe, was one of those. We had ITM Con, which was a massive undertaking that I swore I would never do again, though it was a whole lot of fun. If any of you have not gone back or if you weren't tuning in then, go back and listen to those big milestone episodes, because they are a lot of fun and they go through a lot of sort of Inside the Magic history and things that we've done and been through over the years, and I thought it'd be silly to sort of recap all of that all over again. But that doesn't mean I don't have something special planned for show 400 this week, so stay tuned. We'll definitely be doing that. Of course, the music you're hearing right now is the music that I used to introduce episode 1 of Inside the Magic, so I thought I'd bring that back here, as well as the music at the top of the show was the beginning of the ITM Con episode. So a little bit of a throwback there. But with all that said, it's great that we've reached 400, but really there are bigger things to get to than our own sort of milestone there. So let's jump right into this week's Disney news. Of course, there's a lot coming up this week. Big grand openings coming up on December 6th for many attractions across New Fantasyland and Test Track over at Epcot, the new Test Track, and other attractions as well. All over Walt Disney World, I'll certainly be attending all of the great events, the grand openings, the press events, getting a lot of wonderful interviews, and sort of the scoop on all the details there. Of course, I've already talked about a lot of it, and I'll be talking very much in depth about one of those attractions a little bit later in this week's show, so keep on listening there. But definitely stay tuned on Twitter and on Facebook and on YouTube in the coming days. Actually, December 5th, 6th, and 7th, we'll all have exciting events going on out here at Walt Disney World. Part of it on the 7th will be a What's Next presentation, which I believe, this is just me sort of speculating, me guessing. I'm guessing we're going to hear a little bit about the Avatar project for Disney's Animal Kingdom. We're probably going to hear a bit about the Next Gen project, Fastpass Plus, etc. And who knows what else Disney will be talking about then. So really exciting stuff. Definitely follow along throughout the week on our website and all those social media areas for all of that. Also, part of that, of course, is in New Fantasyland. There are many areas to it. Be Our Guest restaurant. I talked about that, I believe, on last week's show. I also have written a pair of articles that you might be interested in reading. One of them was my second article for Fox News Travel over at, at foxnews.com/travel. You can find it there. There's a pretty extensive write-up on the Be Our Guest restaurant there, as well as a second article that I wrote for InsideTheMagic.net, sort of a closer look at the restaurant, including some video that takes you on a tour of the whole thing, along with photo gallery, some interviews, etc. So head on over to both the Fox News website and our website to check both of those out if you want even more from Be Our Guest. And speaking of the Be Our Guest restaurant, here's something kind of amusing. In preparation for the upcoming press event this week, unveiling a new Fantasyland, officially grand opening, all of that, Disney has put out some fun facts about a number of the attractions that they are opening, Be Our Guest restaurant included in that. And there are definitely some odd facts that they released about the restaurant that I found to be particularly amusing. Apparently, the grimacing figures that are located on the bridge that leads up to the Be Our Guest restaurant, they're all named Frank. Apparently, that's what the construction guys, I guess, named them for ease of saying, hey, I guess we're going to install another Frank over here or something like that. I don't know. Near the entrance, there are sort of on the left and the right are these combination of goat and lion statues. Apparently, those are called Go Lions. Imagine that. And above that are Sneagles, which are a combination of snake and eagle. So you can now refer to all of those by their proper name. Kind of odd, but there they are. Also talking about new Fantasyland here, Disney put out a really fun video this week. Anybody who's watched the show House Hunters, or more specifically House Hunters International on the HGTV network, there was a special sort of mini episode of the show in a video that Disney put online featuring Belle and the Beast, and they were choosing which castle in the Magic Kingdom they wanted to move into. You can probably guess which one they chose between Cinderella Castle and Prince Eric's Castle from the Little Mermaid ride. And of course, well, kind of give it away when you say the name of it, Beast Castle. But no, it's a very amusing video. If you haven't seen that, head on over to the Disney Parks blog to check it out. Continuing with a bit of a new Fantasyland here, also gearing up for this this press event, Disney has begun sort of switching around the artwork that's on the Seven Dwarves Mine Train, because that's really the only major area that is still under construction. You know, they're making it obvious that the remaining construction that's going on in that big area, kind of in the middle of New Fantasyland, is indeed for the Seven Dwarves Mine Train. And amongst the artwork, and the photo was sent to me by listener John, showing Dopey holding a sign that says, "Take a peek," and you can actually peek through the construction wall right there. There's a little hole that allows you to peek through. I think that's kind of fun. That's nice that Disney is sort of understanding that many are interested in seeing what the construction is all about, and you know, people are going to take a peek no matter what. So it's good that Disney is sort of letting everybody take a little peek behind the wall as Seven Dwarves Mine Train construction continues for the next couple of years. One more note about New Fantasyland for this week. Those of you who are going to be attending the grand opening for it on December 6th, the actual opening moment is going to take place at 10 a.m. It's going to be about 15 minutes long, and I believe it's going to be at Cinderella Castle. I haven't gotten 100% of the information for as far as that goes yet, but also included in that would be this mysterious flying dragon that Disney has been talking about for the last week or two. And, of course, you know, we talked about a few months ago, that Disney was testing it out in an airfield in California. Anyway, this flying dragon probably going to be part of this opening ceremony, grand opening ceremony for New Fantasyland. So anybody who wants to sort of take a peek at that, you might have some luck if you're at the Magic Kingdom at 10 a.m., though a lot of what's going on this week, as usually is the case, it's going to be reserved for invited media and such. So definitely stay tuned to our website to check it out that way as well. Well, but in addition to that, Disney has made a smart move this time in removing the merchandise element from the grand opening from the Magic Kingdom. They don't want people lining up for hours and hours and hours in the park just to get some merchandise. So they're actually holding a special separate event, a release party, as they're calling it, over at Disney's Coronado Springs Resort in Room J of the Convention Center area. It's going to be from 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. on December 6th, that grand opening day. It's going to include a whole bunch of pins representing the various attractions that are opening. at New Fantasyland, as well as in Storybook Circus. In addition, there's going to be some annual pass holder exclusive merchandise, like a sling bag and a 24-karat gold coin card. And apparently you're going to be able to line up over there beginning at 4 p.m. on that day and not a minute earlier, because they just won't allow it. So I was talking about some fun facts, continuing along that direction, but moving over to something else that's going to be opening up very soon. Splitsville, the bowling, restaurant, bar, etc. area that's going to be a downtown Disney in the former location of the Virgin Megastore, which was there many years ago. There's some fun facts about Splitsville. It's going to have 30 bowling lanes. There's going to be 20 on the first floor, 10 on the second floor. There'll be 5 bars, 2 sushi bars, an outdoor patio on both floors of the whatever you want to call it, the facility. Live music will be performed every night there, and operating hours will be from 10 a.m. until 2 a.m., so good for some late-night food and fun and socializing and all that good stuff. So should be fun. This coming week, there will be what Disney's calling a media preview of Splitsville, and they haven't really said when it's going to officially open yet, and I think that's because they don't know when they're going to be done. I think they may be a little bit behind schedule on construction on that one, but it should open any day now. They've said early December is really when they plan on opening it, so very well may be done this week, but it might take a few days longer. We shall see. Now, hopping over to the Magic Kingdom, away from all of the hoopla that's going to be going on this week, something else has popped up in a very big way, kind of towering over the Magic Kingdom in a very literal way. It is Rapunzel's Tower. It has shown up in the area that is the former Fantasyland Skyway over near, well, it's kind of in between the Haunted Mansion, and it's a small world. There's a construction zone going on there where there's going to be a new pathway built between those two areas. Some new restrooms will be there, and now Rapunzel's Tower is very, very tall. In fact, you can see it from Frontierland. You can see it throughout Liberty Square. You can certainly see it from the Haunted Mansion area. Of course, Disney's not done with it yet, so they very well may hide those unwanted views with a bunch of trees around it. It is still very much under construction in that area. It's not clear as to how much Rapunzel is going to be going in that area, meet and greet, etc. Disney has really only said that it's going to be a restroom, and although I've heard there's also going to be a D-Zone charging area where you can charge your cell phones and iPads and video cameras and all that good stuff. So yeah, that is under construction. Disney hasn't officially really said much about it, but I imagine we'll be hearing about that pretty soon, seeing as there's now a giant Rapunzel tower from Tangled over the whole thing. All right, in the world of Epcot, looking a bit toward the future, the 20th Epcot International Flower and Garden Festival is coming up in a few months, March 6th through May 19th of 2013, and this time, you know, the line between the Food and Wine Festival and the Flower and Garden Festival seems to be getting a bit blurred. HGTV stars have been involved in both of them, and now apparently Epcot chefs will be involved in the Flower and Garden Festival for the first time, offering a variety of festival-themed food and beverage locations, including a backyard barbecue, garden-inspired, and global tastes. So a little bit of a mix there. In addition, there's going to be a new illuminated garden, as well as the Land of Oz play area that I've talked about on a previous show. New topiaries include a Monsters University topiary, as well as a Radiator Springs interactive play zone. And adding to the Flower Power concert series, new this year, well, next year, I guess, will be the Village People, April 19th through 21st, as well as 1960s singer-songwriter Tommy Rowe. And many of the other regular acts are returning, including Chubby Checker and Paul Revere and the Raiders, and a whole bunch more as well. And speaking of next year, D23, Disney's official fan club, has announced their dates for events throughout 2013. We'll run through those real quick here for those of you who are interested in additional events. The Fanniversaries are coming back from March and April. The cities that they'll be coming back to next year, or going to next year, will be Boston, Chicago, Los Angeles, Newark, Orlando, Phoenix, San Diego, San Francisco, Seattle, and Washington, D.C. Then on April 13th, there's going to be a 50 and Fabulous Son of Flubber event in Burbank, California. Also on that day, Mickey's of Glendale will be hosting a shopping day over at the Walt Disney Imagineering headquarters. On May 4th, D23 will have a day at the Walt Disney Studios and Archives, also on June 1st, same sort of thing. June 8th will be a 50 and Fabulous Summer Magic event in Burbank. On June 8th, another Mickey's of Glendale shopping day. August 9th through 11th, of course, will be the 2013 D23 Expo in Anaheim at the Convention Center there. Then in September, we'll have the Sip and Stroll event, as well as another day at the Walt Disney Studios and Archives. That's going to be September 14th. Another 50 and Fabulous event on September 15th. This one for Sword in the Stone, again at Burbank. November 2nd will be D23 Day at the Walt Disney Studios and Archives once again. November 16th will be From the Vault, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. That sounds particularly interesting. That'll be in Burbank as well. In December of next year, there will be Disney and Dickens in Burbank, as well as D23's Holiday Splendor at Walt Disney World. So a variety of events to look forward to throughout the year, beginning in March and continuing all the way through December. And a whole bunch of really good Disney Blu-rays have come out recently, and I've had so much to talk about here on the show that I haven't really had a chance to do too many Blu-ray reviews, but I have posted a few over at InsideTheMagic.net. That includes Brave, which had a very extensive, exhaustive amount of bonus features on that Blu-ray, so you can read more about that over at InsideTheMagic.net. Also, Pixar Shorts Collection 2 came out. A really interesting feature on that is a bunch of short films from some of the biggest names at Pixar that were they made while they were in college. Very, very entertaining there. And of course, they introduce them, tell the stories behind them, quite amusing as well. And then just in time for the holiday season, there is Prep and Landing, the original, as well as the sequel, and a bunch of other fun little bonus features as well. So if you want to read reviews of all those Blu-ray releases, head on over to our website. And moving into the world of movies, Variety is reporting that Disney has hired a pair of writers from Safety Not Guaranteed, and they are apparently working on a remake of Flight of the Navigator. I'm not sure that movie really needs to be made, remade, but apparently it's in the works, so we'll see how that goes. Also from Walt Disney Animation Studios, the next big animated film, feature film, is going to be called Frozen, and another director has been added to that film. Chris Buck was already attached, and now Jennifer Lee has been added to the movie as well to direct, and that movie comes out next year. And coming soon to Blu-ray and DVD and all that good stuff will be Frank and Weenie, but unfortunately not in time for Christmas. Surprisingly, it's not going to be available until January 8th. Included amongst the bonus features on the Frank and Weenie release will be an all-new original short called Captain Sparky versus the Flying Saucer, which sounds Flying Saucers, which sounds pretty amusing. Behind-the-scenes featurette with Tim Burton called Miniatures in Motion, bringing Frank and Weenie to life. A showcase of the film's touring exhibit, as well as Tim Burton's original live-action short, Frank and Weenie, and more. And that'll do it for your news from around the world this week, except for one really major thing that happened this weekend over at Epcot, which I'll be talking about here in just a few minutes. But before we get to all of that excitement, it is time for a tip for today, and this one comes in from Cheney, and I really like this idea. Cheney writes, a common struggle for anyone planning their Walt Disney World trip is how crowded it will be. Living a few states away from Disney means we only really visit during the busiest times of year. My last trip to Disney World was a little different and a little wet. We stayed at Saratoga Springs Resort for 3 days and visited both Hollywood Studios and the Magic Kingdom. Unfortunately for us, the day we went to the Magic Kingdom, it poured down rain. Main Street had a river running down it, and people were running from shop to shop trying to stay dry. And those Disney ponchos were selling like hotcakes. As the day progressed and the rain continued to pour, more and more people just gave up and left the park. My parents had enough, but my brother and I decided to stay. I'm a huge Disney fan, and I was going to soak, no pun intended, intended, it in no matter what. With the park basically empty, we were able to get on and off rides as we wanted. We rode Space Mountain 7 times, Splash Mountain 4 times, the Haunted Mansion twice, the list goes on. All the shops were cleared, and we were able to look around and take our time before buying pins and other merchandise to make the experience even better. Extra magic hours made it so we could stay until 2 a.m. The rain stopped around 11 and we grabbed a quick bite to eat, being the only people basically on Main Street. My hands were wrinkled like prunes, my shoes had puddles in them, and I gave up wearing a poncho. It was the most fun I've ever had at Disney. No lines for anything. The park basically to yourself. You can't beat that. Cheney, great tip. You know, I've had some really fun days just being absolutely drenched in the park. Sometimes you're there, you're with people. Like you said, you can only come so often, and it rains, and there's nothing you can do about it. You can be miserable, you can hide from the rain, you can wear a poncho, which is kind of a pain, or you can just leave and go do something else. But you know what? If you don't mind just putting away your electronics for the day and just going out there and getting wet and just being wet and taking it all in and walking around, the wrinkling and the soggy shoes and all that can get a little bit uncomfortable, but if you can ignore that, it's kind of fun to just walk around wet all day. You certainly stay cool, and you do indeed get to ride many rides very, very quickly, because most people don't want to walk around wet all day. It's not for everybody, but it can be fun. Everybody else, email your tips into tips@insidethemagic.net.
Now, an Inside the Magic contest.
And it is indeed in honor of show 400, time for a contest, something used to do a lot more here on the show. Haven't done so much recently, and happy to do one now. And it's a pretty epic contest for appropriate for this milestone of a show number 400. And I say epic specifically, I use that word for a very good reason, because I have 3 copies of Epic Mickey 2 to give away on this week's show, as well as 3 more copies to give away over at InsideTheMagic.net. That's 6 copies total. Yes, I can do math. And here's the really cool part. Not only am I giving away copies of Epic Mickey 2, but each copy comes with those popular Oswald ear hats. I don't even have one of these yet, but I promise you that every single one of these copies that I'm giving away of Epic Mickey 2, the video game, The Power of Two, as it's subtitled, will indeed be coming with an Oswald ear hat. So for this particular podcast contest, I'm going to be giving away 1 Nintendo Wii copy, as well as 2 Nintendo 360 Xbox 360 copies. For the website, the contest that'll be coming up this week, it'll actually be the platform of your choice. So visit InsideTheMagic.net either tomorrow, Monday, or possibly Tuesday to find out how to enter that portion of it. But right now, seeing as it's not only a big milestone for Inside the Magic, show 400, as I've said, but also a huge week for Walt Disney World, I've decided to integrate that into how you can win a copy of Epic Mickey 2. There are going to be several attraction official openings this week, and the contest is going to be for you to name the characters for each of the following attractions. Kind of fill in the blank, and if you correctly fill in those blanks and email me with the answer, email to contest@insidethemagic.net before the deadline of Saturday, December 9th at 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time, then you'll be entered into a chance to have your name randomly drawn for one of these Epic Mickey 2 copies. Please also include whether you want the Wii copy or the 360 copy. I'll do my best to accommodate you. So here are the questions that you need to answer in the email. From New Fantasyland, number 1, it's Enchanted Tales with blank. Fill in that character. Number 2, Blank Tavern. What character would fill that in? Number 3, Under the Sea, Journey of blank. And then we'll hop over to Disney's Hollywood Studios for the 4th, another attraction that is officially opening this week, The Legend of blank. One final question, though. That was four blanks there, but you have to have this fifth one as well. And this one relates to what I'll be talking about here in just a few minutes. Over at Epcot, the new test track will be officially opening up in just a few days, along with New Fantasyland and all the rest of that. And while we're going to be talking about the new form of test track here in a minute, let's think back to that classic test track experience. So my question is, who... what was the character name of the ride's male narrator in the original classic test track experience? Also, the host of the pre-show. Same guy. What's that guy's name? I think Google will be your friend on that one if you haven't been on test track in a while. So there it is. Five answers that you have to email to contest@insidethemagic.net. In the subject line, this is very important, please put Epic Mickey Contest. If you don't put that as your subject line, I might not see your email. It might get filed away. It might end up in the trash, spam, junk, you know, all that kind of thing. So please put that as your subject line. I'll be sure to gather them all together, and I'll announce the winner, or rather three winners, on next week's show. And again, look for a second chance to win a copy of Epic Mickey as well, Epic Mickey 2, that is, as well as Oswald the Ears this week on InsideTheMagic.net. So there it is, your show 400 contest. And also stay tuned to InsideTheMagic.net. Keep coming back throughout the month of December, because I have a lot of stuff that I want to give away. It's pretty cool stuff, too. So keep coming back for all of that. So good luck on our show 400 contest. And now I do want to talk about the all-new test track experience over at Epcot in just a minute. But first, it's time for another one of those Inside the Magic dance breaks. As always, this dance break has been brought to you by the number one dance game brand, Just Dance, which has met the magical world of Disney in the newest and coolest video game for the whole family. It's called Just Dance Disney Party. You can dance to songs from some of your favorite beloved Disney classic films, like what you're hearing now, The Little Mermaid, as well as Beauty and the Beast, Jungle Book, Cinderella, as well as songs from some of the coolest Disney Channel shows, including Phineas and Ferb and many others. It is perfect for kids of all ages. Just Dance Disney Party is a great way to keep the family active, and it is now available at major retailers for Xbox 360 Kinect, as well as the Nintendo Wii. So pick up your copy today. And now I want to take you to Epcot. That sound should be pretty familiar. It's been a sound missing from Epcot for a number of months now, as the classic test track attraction that's been open since 99 or so has went down to become sort of an all-new test track, a very futuristic version. And just this weekend, it soft opened, first to cast members, then to cast members and their guests. And just today, I heard that just guests were able to head in there in advance of the December 6th grand opening in just a few days. And I believe that will continue, though no guarantees. But anyway, I had a chance to ride the new test track many, many, many times. In fact, I lost count of just how many times I actually rode the new test track, because it was wonderfully fun. It was the most fun I've had on test track in many, many years. A ride that just kind of got old. It got dated. It screamed 90s, although it opened at the very end of the 1990s. And of course, the queue was loud and banging and clanging, and all of the test facility theming just kind of got old over the years. And now the whole attraction has been sort of made over, or remade over, into something that is most definitely entirely new and much of it is very, very, very Tron-like. We've said before when I interviewed the Imagineers that were sort of behind this remake of Test Track over at Epcot, it's pretty clear that they had some Tron influence, though they wanted to make it clear this is not a Tron ride, although as everybody's kind of calling it Tron Track at this point, it definitely has a Tron-style aesthetic to it, but it is definitely not a Tron ride. It's not intended to be a Tron ride. However, there's quite a lot about it that you know, really has some similarities there to what especially in Tron Legacy, the look of sort of black backgrounds and the sort of bright, vibrant colored lines running everywhere. But I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself here, because let's sort of start back out at the exterior of the new test track, and I want to sort of talk our way through what is cool, what is new, what is unique about the ride as we lead up to the grand opening in just a few days. Of course, this is a bit spoiler. Those of you who want to be surprised by what Test Track, the new Test Track, is all about, you're going to want to, essentially not listen to the next very long while, because I'm going to talk all about definitely my thoughts on what the new Test Track is like. So, hopping on over to Epcot, it all sort of begins outside the new facade, the new entrance area of Test Track, which is a gray and blue look. Very concrete, a sort of futuristic look. Definitely a stark difference from the yellow and black motif that was there years ago. On the left side is Fastpass and Single Rider Line, which is nice to have. It's definitely a big way to skip most of the queue. But on the right side is the standby entrance, and throughout the entrance area, what's really fun are these blue, new blue trash cans. Of course, Disney's themed trash cans are always fun, and what's really great about these is not only does it have the new sort of TT Test Track logo, but also has the old World of Motion logo, and this World of Motion logo actually continues throughout the queue on many signs. Many of the directional signs, you'll see this logo. The Imagineers have definitely paid tribute to that old attraction that used to be in that area. So you step inside the new queue, and it is obvious from the moment you enter that it is very, very, very different inside Test Track. They've gutted the queue completely. It is doesn't even vaguely resemble the old one. The paths are different. There are ramps where there were not ramps. There are rooms where there were not rooms, and there's just nothing similar about it. It's not an overlay of the queue, as it kind of is with the ride. The queue is completely new, and as soon as you walk in, you're presented with, of course, the ride is actually Test Track presented by Chevrolet. So the Chevrolet sort of motif is consistent throughout the entire ride, and even gets a little advertisement-y at times. So you walk in, and you see a Chevrolet concept car, this silver, sleek-looking car with a video in the background that, again, is very Tron-like, very futuristic, sort of computer grid-like behind it. And as you're walking through the queue, you continue on through some lighted displays. Some of them have some depth to it, which is kind of cool. They're almost 3D displays. And there's this sort of deconstructed concept vehicle in the middle. If you've looked at any of the concept art for the new Test Track, this is what you've seen, this first queue area. And I must say, the audio that's in this queue area is quite serene. I'm going to turn down this Tron music here, which I'm appropriately playing here, and I'll actually pipe in some of the actual queue audio here. Here's what it sounds like to walk through the queue, which is going to be a very, very big difference from the loud banging music that was there before. So as you can hear, a very peaceful, sort of serene experience there in the new Test Track queue. Gone is the headache-inducing old queue, which is a wonderful thing. As you move along in the queue, you encounter some more sort of artwork and displays and that kind of thing along the way. Nothing particularly interesting, though, as I said, the 3D displays are kind of neat. You turn a corner into another room that is a really cool sort of a projection-mapped concept vehicle that there's a video of Chevrolet car designers sort of explaining the process of designing a car. And while they're doing that, you can actually see sketch lines forming on a car and color begins to fill in. And they're explaining what it is, basically what the process of designing a car is. And they're doing this for a really a good purpose. It's not just to educate and let you know, hey, this is how we design cars at Chevrolet. But more importantly, it's showing exactly what you are going to be doing in just a few minutes, because the Chevrolet Design Center is a huge component of the new attraction. Not so much the ride portion itself, though it does influence that a bit, but really... this is a huge new element to Test Track, because previously when you would enter the sort of the pre-show room, it was just a video. It was a pre-show video. You watched it. You moved on. The end. Now in this new very big space with a lot of touchscreen displays, you're first handed a little RFID card, and then you move into the next room. And once inside there, you are assigned a specific spot to go to a specific touchscreen kiosk with a very large screen, and at that point you have a chance to design your own vehicle. Now this is a really nice sort of integration of an interactive queue, if you will. This is not sort of a gimmicky game little thing that you can just sort of play with while you're waiting in line. This is actually going to be a component, a part of the ride itself, and while you're playing with it, you don't feel like you're waiting, and that's really the point. You feel like you're doing something. It's not a game. You're actually sort of actively engaged in this creative capacity of sorts, you know, creating your own car. So you tap your little RFID card that you were handed to the glowing circle, which is something everybody should get familiar with pretty soon, because Disney's going to be putting these everywhere throughout Walt Disney World. And as you work your way through the design phase, you first pick whether you want a car or a truck as the type of car that you want, and then you run through a whole bunch of different portions of the design, including drawing a line to sort of create the basic shape of what you want the car to be, and then the computer will sort of smooth that out for you and make it a little bit more aerodynamic, and then you can kind of tweak it from there. After that, you can pick a number of different attributes for your car, from the way the face looks, the color, the wheels, sort of details on there, the engine type, the length, the width. It goes on and on, and you have about, oh, I don't know, 5 minutes or so in this room to do that, which I think is a pretty good amount of time. It's not so long that you get there and you're done and you're bored and you're just waiting around, but it's not so short that you ever feel rushed. More importantly, when you're waiting in line now on Test Track, you're really going to be engaged. You're not just going to be standing there watching these sort of silly crash test items like it has been going on for so many years. Instead, you are, having a little bit of creativity, a little bit of fun. Everybody that I was watching that was doing it, and even as I was doing it myself, really seemed to be enjoying designing your own vehicle in there. There was really no reason given as to why you were doing that. It was just, here, step in front of this touchscreen and go to work, and everybody seemed to really know what was going on. There was no confusion. It was pretty self-explanatory, and I think it was actually quite a bit of fun. Disney's done a really nice job with putting so many options that everybody can really customize this very well. You can do it individually, or you can do it as a group. Everybody can sort of work together if you're a family. I heard a lot of kids with their parents sort of getting really excited about it and saying, oh, I want a monster truck and that kind of thing. So and then of course, as I've said, there are many Tron influences to this new version of Test Track, and that it becomes very, very obvious in this car design area, because if you make your car black and then you enter sort of the detailing areas, they have added some very specific Tron elements, Tron style elements, the bright glowing lines, the weird circuit looking designs that you can put on there, some wheels that definitely would not exist in the real world but certainly exist in the world of Tron. It all fits very much in that motif, so it's quite clear that Tron was a heavy influence on the look and the feel of this new Test Track, while it's again not actually a Tron ride. So it's kind of this fun sort of medium area. Anybody who's not a Tron fan, you'll still appreciate the new look of the ride and the queue and everything. Very futuristic, fits into future world very well at Epcot, but those of you who are Tron fans like me will certainly appreciate the ability to design a car that looks a heck of a lot like a light cycle or a light runner or any number of other vehicles that are present in Tron Legacy. So the design phase, again, very fun. as you move on from there, once it's all over, you do have to wait a little bit once you're done with your design. If you made it through ahead, there's a countdown on your screen that runs. It gives you a rating and the different efficiency and power and speed and et cetera as to how your vehicle will perform once you're out there on the track. And really, that is the point of designing the car. You're going to take your card with you as you move on into the loading area, which is going to be the one part of this whole experience where you kind of get in there, or the first part, rather, that you get in there and you're like, oh, yeah, I remember this. This looks like Test Track, except completely different. It has the same layout as the old loading area, but definitely looks, has a very gray and blue look to it now. So as you approach the loading area, you are carrying your design with you on this RFID-equipped card, and there are now these little glowing TT logos. One per person, six of them per car, that you tap your card on there and it accesses your design. And there's a little screen there that confirms that it has loaded up your design for your seat that you'll be sitting on the ride. And once you're on the ride, it will compare your design against basically the maneuvers that you've done on the ride. And, with that said, I want to take you on the ride now. So make sure you wear your headphones for this. I got a really pristine, excellent binaural recording of the full new Test Track experience. And, of course, those of you watching the video version, you'll have a chance to enjoy that as well. Of course, over on our YouTube channel, I've already posted a full video, not only of the queue and the pre-show and the post-show and all of that, but 1080p full HD video of the ride. So definitely check that out if you haven't already. But anyway, without further ado, let me turn down the music here and let's hop aboard the all-new Test Track experience over at Epcot.
Hello, the seatbelt check is around the corner. For your safety, remain seated with your seatbelt fastened through your hands, arms, feet, and legs inside the vehicle at all times. And please supervise children. Thank you.
La estación de control de cinturones de seguridad está a la vuelta de la esquina. Por su seguridad, mantenga sus manos, brazos, pies y piernas dentro del vehículo y cuide a los niños.
Automated driving technology activated.
Welcome to the C track. We'll begin with the capability test to see how your vehicle designs perform under challenging weather and surface conditions.
Monitoring road surface. Connecting to OnStar. SIM car performance data acquired.
Let's see how your designs hold up now.
Commencing SIM car off-road and extreme weather sequence. Test results displayed and verified.
Now let's see how your vehicles do when it comes to their efficiency.
Scanning SIM card for optimal fuel efficiency. Engaging eco scan for aerodynamic efficiency. Systems analysis, hyperspectral imaging in progress. Calculating total enviro impact. Commencing responsiveness test.
Okay, the responsiveness data is now being synchronized.
Automated driving technology verified and active. Automated crash avoidance technology disengaged. Displaying responsiveness data.
Here comes the final test.
Energizing four-pack test. Results. SimTrack performance testing complete.
This concludes your performance testing. You'll be able to see how your Chevrolet custom concept vehicle designs compare with the Sim car after you disembark. Please watch your step as you exit, and remember to take all your personal belongings with you. Be sure to check your final performance numbers in our scoring area.
So there it is. The new test track over at Epcot. Certainly, you know, let's backtrack a little bit so I can talk a bit on my thoughts about what the experience is like. The flow of it, certainly, definitely the same as it always was. It's the same track. However, it's an entirely new experience, that's for sure. As you move through from the very first hill that you ascend all the way through the very end, it is, well, almost the end, that is, it is totally new and unique looking. The Tron influence that I've been talking about, certainly a very dark around you with a lot of glowing lines and a lot of projections. It's clear that Imagineering really, really likes projections now, and they're everywhere, and they've built these huge walls throughout the attraction that block you off from seeing future scenes. Of course, the old test track, you could look ahead, very much so. You could see a lot of cars going through various tests, if you will, various maneuvers ahead of you. You could kind of see what was coming up. You can't do that anymore. They've built these giant walls, probably 20, 25 foot tall walls that they've projected all kinds of these computer looking graphics, colors, and lines running everywhere, and none of it really means anything, but it's cool looking. A lot of blues, a lot of greens and yellows and oranges, vibrant colors, and throughout the ride they just persist. A lot of archways that have these sort of glowing, you know, pulsating visuals that go around you. It's a very cool looking ride. It definitely makes you feel like you're in, you know, you're on the grid, basically. You're in a computer. And as you go through, the you know, sort of the bumpy road near the beginning isn't there anymore. It's very smooth up until the moment where you get up to that first sort of acceleration into the what used to be the braking test, the, you know, what used to be the anti-lock brakes test, essentially, with and without. Just prior to that, there was that little OnStar advertisement, which I thought was a little odd to throw that in there, a little product placement. But then again, the whole thing is sponsored by Chevrolet. So, sure, why not? Just a little name dropping of a service in there. But as you move through, it's not quite as clear as it used to be exactly what's going on, what you're testing, how your design that you did in the queue has influenced the ride itself, until you finally reach one of the scoreboards. And that's when you sort of put two and two together and say, oh, I get it now. As you're driving through, you approach a lot of projection screens. As I said, there's one cool moment where it looks like you're driving out into this sort of this Tron grid-like area, and it almost looks like you got derezzed. You know, lots of blocks flying everywhere. And there's a lightning strike when they talked about you know, extreme weather, a very digital looking lightning strike, which is pretty cool, and a sort of a Tron City look to it as you come around a corner. But as I was saying, you get to sort of these scoring screens that show you how each person in the vehicle's different cars have compared thus far, and they update you periodically throughout the ride, ranking you for second, third, and then three more after that. And it's based on the different tests and the different different components, the different attributes that you've assigned to your design throughout. And so you can actually have sort of a winner within your car as you reach the end of the whole ride. Some people have been disappointed that the hot and cold tests are gone. Those rooms are still there, but now they're sort of scan you, and then there's a fun moment where you can actually see yourself riding in the car as the aerodynamics test is blowing overhead, a sort of a computer simulation of your car being aerodynamic. And so that's kind of a fun little moment. The hairpin turns and all of that kind of stuff that was near the end, getting close to the end of the ride, is still there, but now it all looks blue with the black backgrounds. As I said, the trees are still there, but they're lit in laser light. And even that truck that comes head-on is still there in the ride, but now it's lit in laser light as well. So definitely an overlay to the existing test track experience, but all making it look very computerized and futuristic. And then, of course, the coolest moment, in my opinion, is as you're approaching the exterior portion of the ride, the lead-up to that power test, as they're calling it, is the best visual, the new visual in the whole thing. There's this awesome series of sort of these archways that you pass through, and music comes on, and all these lines are going past you, and it really feels like you are testing the power of your vehicle. It's quite the launch moment as you head out to the exterior portion. Unfortunately, once you get outside, it's the same old test track, and there's not really any sort of new cool visuals to look at. I really wish they had enclosed that outdoor portion and had amazing sort of projections going around you as you were going through that. Instead, it still just looks like a road, and you can still look around and see backstage Epcot, and it doesn't really fit with the rest of the ride, which is unfortunate. But then once you get back inside, you're sort of immersed back into it, and you see a final score, how everybody stacked up against each other. So overall, the new test track experience, a lot of fun. The ride still follows the same twists and turns, still a high speed, the fastest ride at Walt Disney World. Still very thrilling, but also some really excellent new visuals to go with it. And anybody who's a Tron fan will certainly love everything about the new test track. And even those who are not, pretty much everybody has said that's been there and that has ridden it has said it is an improvement over the previous version that was feeling old and dated and tired and just ready for it to go. Your design experience, or rather your design, doesn't end with you at the end of the ride, though. You actually carry it with you off the ride. You continue to hold that card, the RFID equipped card. Take it with you into the post-show area. First, you'll be able to tap it against a screen, as it's actually this very, very large screen, and it gives you your personal final score, and it shows you how you've stacked up against other cars for the day. Kind of keeps a high score list, and you can keep going back and back again and keep trying different attributes on your car in order to get the ultimate design. I'm sure somebody will figure out what design it takes to really win every time. I'll certainly work on that because I plan on going back and riding many more times. Another post-show area allows you to take your design and sort of create this little virtual commercial for it, which is not terribly great. It shows your design, which is cool. You can email it to yourself, and that way you can keep the car virtually that you designed, but it's not terribly interesting. There were a couple of stations that were not quite working yet this weekend where you can actually take your car and drive around a virtual track. So I look forward to trying that in the future. And then there are a series of photo opportunities as well where you can scan your card once again and pose in front of a variety of virtual backgrounds as well as with you with your own car. And of course, returning as usual is the showroom of real cars at the end, all Chevy products, of course, and a gift shop, which didn't quite look complete and finished just yet when I went through this weekend. So that is pretty much the story of the new test track over at Epcot. It was about, I'd say, 97% done when I went through this weekend. Definitely getting very, very close to grand opening coming up here in a few days on December 6th. Hopefully, they'll do something really fun for the actual grand opening moment, which is going to take place a little bit later in the day on the 6th. I'll definitely be there for that. Looking forward to it. But overall, I would say rush out and see this. This is going to be a new hit attraction once again at Epcot. Test track has always always brought huge crowds to, huge lines, that is, at Epcot, of course. Since it's been closed for the last few months, Soarin' certainly has had very, very long lines, and it'll be good to have the crowds sort of dispersed throughout Future World, not focused on just one side. And I have a feeling Test Track is once again going to overtake Soarin' for the lines, although they were moving the cars very, very quickly, very efficiently. The Fast Pass line and the single rider line are one and the same, and it cuts off a large portion of the ride. Apparently, you can still design a car a little bit as you go through the Fast Pass area, but you're very limited as to how much input you have. You have to sort of pick from kind of some existing attributes. You can't quite go as in depth, because the whole point is to sort of blast through there and get on the ride as quickly as possible, not to spend 5 minutes designing something. So that is sort of my report from the new Test Track over at Epcot. Of course, you can head to InsideTheMagic.net to see even more from it. As I said, I've got a complete video of the 17-minute video, actually, of the entire queue, the exterior, the pre-show, the Chevrolet Design Center, that whole process, along with the ride itself in full 1080p HD with the binaural audio that you just heard, as well as the post-show area. So check that out on our YouTube channel, as well as a whole photo gallery of everything over on the website. And come back next week and in the coming weeks to hear more about the grand opening of this new Test Track, as well as hopefully some good interviews where I can find out just why decisions were made about the new ride. And definitely go check it out. It's a lot of fun. Soft openings are going on, as far as I know, right now, between now and the grand opening, and then, of course, grand opening December 6th. And now, before we do a little listener feedback to round out this show, I do want to put in a quick word about Lanyard Lab. If you have a business to promote, or maybe you're attending a convention or a church or a school or anywhere you have to wear a name tag or an ID around your neck, a custom lanyard's a great way to do it. You can customize yours over at lanyardlab.com. Click anywhere that says get a quote. Fill out the easy form there. You can select your colors, your size, your material style. You can add any graphics that you want, pick your attachments, etc. Submit all that to us, and we'll email you back with not only a price quote for your design, but also a proof showing you what it'll look like as a lanyard. All of that is free to try. There's no obligation to purchase, and if you like what you see, you can then purchase it online. It's really, really very simple. So check it out over at lanyardlab.com. That's LanyardLab.com.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Ricky, this is amazing.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Inside the Magic, listener feedback.
And let's round out show 400 with some listener feedback, starting with an email from Rachel from New York, who writes, on the Disney Cruise Line, I think a lot of people tend to forget about the arcade as a source of entertainment. I would suggest that if you have the budget, getting a card with a certain amount of points for your stay, or renew the points on your card per day, so that way your little ones, or adults, no judging, can go to the arcade and play some games and escape the Disney atmosphere for a little bit. Or if your kids are a little bit older and you feel comfortable, sometimes it can be a good midday break for parents to go back to their cabin, take a nap, watch a movie, whatnot, and the big kids can go play in the arcade and come back when their points are used up. Rachel, definitely good suggestion there for the Disney Cruise Line. The arcade is not huge, but definitely has some fun games, and is a good way, like you said, to sort of escape from the Disney for a little bit. Next email comes in from David, who writes, first, a happy belated birthday, and congratulations on your 400th show. I've been listening / watching every week for the past few years, and your website has become one of my most visited websites. I really enjoy all the up-to-date information, all the videos that you post. My family and I will be visiting Walt Disney World the week before Christmas. While it is not our first time visiting Walt Disney World, it will be our first time staying on property and visiting during the holiday season. To add to the excitement is the fact that New Fantasyland will be just a couple of weeks old. Having said that, I have a question. Do you have any tips for enjoying Walt Disney World and Mickey's Very Merry Christmas Party, i.e. highlights, places to watch the parade, fireworks, managing time in large crowds, etc.? I know it's going to be difficult to enjoy everything with the events going on, plus the fact this is one of the busiest times of the year. I feel like it's one of those so much to see, so little time situations. Well, David, first of all, thank you for all of the you know, the birthday and the congratulations and the, all the wishes and all of that, and for listening and watching for so very, very long. To answer your questions, yes, you're coming at certainly a very busy time, not only because it is going to be the week before Christmas, which is always very busy, but also with all of the new attractions open, new Fantasyland and Test Track and everything else, it's definitely going to be a pretty exciting time, and I would imagine the lines will be very long. So to just give you a few tips here, let's say, for Mickey's Very Merry Christmas Party, that's a good time to actually ride things. I'm sure you want to partake in the Christmas festivities, which, in my opinion, really the highlights of the Very Merry Party are the parade and the fireworks. Everything else, you can kind of skip it. You really wouldn't miss it. Definitely skip the thing between the pre-parade Kringle Crew thing. Stay as far away from Main Street during that as possible. That's just simply obnoxious. It's got like hip-hop versions of Christmas songs, and it's annoying. So get away from that. But the parade is great if you've never seen it before. The fireworks, special holiday fireworks, certainly wonderful as well. You could try to get some hot chocolate and some cookies. It's included with your ticket, but they're not particularly good either. The chocolate's all right. The cookies this year, when I was there at least, were, not as high quality as they have been in the past. So, definitely it is a great time to ride rides. And during Very Merry, you could certainly go over to New Fantasyland, check out The Little Mermaid, check out, Enchanted Tales with Belle, check out, all of that stuff, Gaston's Tavern, grab some LeFou's Brew. As far as the Be Our Guest restaurant goes, if you're there earlier in the day, you may even be able to land a sort of a last-minute reservation or maybe even a walk-up. You could eat there. You go for lunch, go for dinner. You can get in as of 4 p.m. with your Very Merry ticket into the park. So if you weren't planning on going early, you maybe can do that. So some good tips there for the party in general. Let's see, what else did you say? Places to watch the fireworks and the parades. One of my favorite places to watch the parade is over almost to the barbershop, sort of in the front of Main Street. As you're entering the park, you go through Town Square. It's on the left side. It's where the parade, comes on and off over there. It's a good place to watch. Not a lot of people gather there all the time until the very last minute. So if you stake out that spot a little bit ahead of time, it's a fun spot. Depending on the direction the parade is going, it'll either be the very last thing or the very first thing for the parade. So a good spot there. As far as the fireworks go, I usually don't stake out a spot for that. I just kind of wait for the announcement and just walk up right when they start. There's really not a bad place to watch the fireworks from. Of course, if you want to see the castle, that's the best place, having the castle with the fireworks behind it, projections on the castle, etc., etc. Really, fireworks are meant to be enjoyed from anywhere. They're huge and booming in the sky, and they play the music pretty loudly throughout many areas. So there is that. As far as dealing with the crowds, all I can say is go early to the parks, stay late, skip the middle of the day when everybody is there, go do something else, take a nap, go in the pool, whatever. The weather at this time of year is still pool weather. It was quite hot out today. I think tomorrow I'm looking at the weather's going to be 81 degrees. Definitely pool weather even in December down here in Florida. So there you go. Some tips. Have a good time, most importantly. Next email from Kevin, who writes, for the listener who recently asked about Disney magazines, I would add that D23 members also get a subscription to the Disney 23 magazine, a quarterly publication, and also there are unofficial magazines like Celebrations that focus on the magic of Walt Disney World. Kevin, very good point, though the world of print seems to be on its way out. Disney is still having a bit of a part there with the D23 magazine. Next email comes in from Matt from Phoenix, Arizona, who writes, I've been listening to your shows for some time now. I've always had this question, but have forgotten to ask. When I would go to Disneyland when I was young, around 2005 to 2007, after getting off Autopia, there was this big shop located in what is now the queue for Finding Nemo Submarine Voyage. My guess is the shop was there because there was space open due to the old Submarine Voyage being closed. This was my favorite shop. There was a Nintendo 64-esque handheld video game in the shape of Mickey. I loved that thing. There were many fun games to play based off classic Disney rides like Pirates of the Caribbean, Haunted Mansion, Splash Mountain, Big Thunder, and some others. I believe the shop is now known as Autopia's Autopia Winner's Circle and has been moved next to the entrance of Autopia. It's much smaller and not a whole lot of variety in it. I was wondering if you remember the old shop at all or the video game at all, because I would love to buy it again. Everywhere I look, there seems to be no record of it. Matt, unfortunately, I am no help whatsoever. I don't remember that. I certainly was at Disneyland during that time period, but not as much, not nearly as much as I am now. In fact, that was sort of my early days of ever going to Disneyland, so I don't remember that, unfortunately, but I have a feeling some of you out there may know what Matt's talking about. If you do, feel free to send over any pictures or links or anything like that that may enlighten us all. Let's do just a couple of more emails here and then we will wrap it up. Next is from Justin from St. Louis, who writes, "My wife and I are going to Disney World during the second week of December. My wife is dead set on riding every ride, including Kali River Rapids. I'm concerned about the temperature being too cold to get as wet as you can on Kali, but I am having a hard time convincing her that it is a bad idea, as she has never ridden it. She's not been to Walt Disney World since she was a kid in 1990, and I haven't been since 2003, so we want to make the best of our time, ride everything we can. I just don't want to walk around the park and freeze. What is the weather like during this time in December? Will it be warm enough for Kali River Rapids?" Well, Justin, as I just mentioned a few minutes ago, it was cold for a little while. I actually had to put on some jeans and a sweatshirt and that kind of thing, and then all of a sudden the last couple of days it became very hot, record heat, I believe, for this time of year. It is going up into the 80s this week, and then it'll dip a little bit into the 70s and back up into the 80s, and I have a feeling that trend is going to continue. It's probably going to be a warm Christmas season this year, so I honestly would not worry about it. In fact, when the sun is out and it's in the 80s, it feels hot, and you will welcome a trip on Kali River Rapids. So certainly, play it by ear. We can have some cold snaps every once in a while, but I have a feeling you'll be just fine riding that and any other water ride. Next up, a pair of emails from Timothy. First one, he writes, "Just listened to your show from last week. I've been at Disney for about a week and a half, and I heard the tip about reflections of Earth and then wishes, and I wanted to make a comment on it. I did the same thing one night. I went to Reflections of Earth, and then as soon as it was over, I hopped the monorail to the Transportation and Ticket Center, then took the other monorails in the Magic Kingdom and got into the park a couple of minutes into the Celebrate the Magic show and got a good spot at the end of Main Street for wishes. So the method does work. Later, I also figured out that you could watch the 6:45 Fantasmic at Hollywood Studios and still see the other two. So theoretically, you could see all the big shows in one night. If you wanted to, you could also add the Animal Kingdom Parade and see all the big events at each park in one day. It would be exhausting, but it would definitely be fun." Timothy, good for confirmation that you can catch Illuminations as well as Wishes and perhaps even Fantasmic all in one night. And yeah, probably exhausting, but definitely fun. The other email Timothy wrote in about was in regards to the fact that I had not eaten at, I still haven't eaten at Be Our Guest in New Fantasyland for lunch. Well, Timothy did, and he wrote, "I just wanted to let you know that I did go to lunch at Be Our Guest. I had the braised pork, and it was incredible. It was pork that was really tender and easy to eat. Came in a bowl on top of some mashed potatoes and vegetables on top of the pork. I took the whole bowl and mixed everything together instead of eating just the vegetables, the pork, and then the mashed potatoes. It was very good, and I left full. I also got the triple chocolate cupcake for dessert, which you said in the show was amazing. You said he hadn't tried the lunch menu, so I thought you would appreciate some information." And I do, Timothy. Thanks very much for that. I definitely look forward to trying out the lunch offerings for Be Our Guest pretty soon. And we'll go ahead and end the listener feedback for this week there. And that wraps up show 400. See, I'm used to saying 300, and it's actually 400 because we've turned over into that, 400 episodes, really? That is a lot of episodes, doing that week after week after week for many years now, since 2005. But it's fun. I'm glad so many of you have been listening and more recently even watching the YouTube version of this show for so long. I look forward to producing every week for you, and I'm glad everybody is still enjoying it. And in celebration celebration of this week's show. Don't forget, we have that contest going on for copies of Epic Mickey 2, The Power of Two, for Wii and 360, and coming up on the website some more, as well as each copy coming with those Oswald ear hats, which everybody wants to get their hands on, myself included. So, and these are not the red ones that you can purchase in the parks. These are the blue ones that were given away at Comic-Con and at E3, and I think you could do pre-orders at GameStop for the games, and you would get them there, but it's that one. It's the blue one. So definitely enter that contest. Good luck with that. And if you want even more from the new test track at Epcot, head on over to InsideTheMagic.net and check our YouTube channel, and also, yeah, both of those places to see video, photos, and all about that awesome new ride. One of my favorites, if not my favorite, at Epcot now. I'm definitely looking forward to riding it many more times. So I do want to thank Magical Travel for sponsoring this week's episode of Inside the Magic. You can find out more about their services by visiting magicaltravel.com. And also check out Just Dance Disney Party. It's available now at major retailers. It is for Xbox 360 and Nintendo Wii. A great way to get moving and groove to some fun Disney tunes. Also, once again, I'll mention, if you're doing some holiday shopping over at Amazon, please click through InsideTheMagic.net/Amazon first. We'll get a little bit of credit for that. And I thank you for that and for tuning in. Once again, InsideTheMagic.net is the website, your source for Disney and theme park news between episodes of this show. Be sure to follow us on Twitter and Facebook and YouTube to stay up to date with all of the exciting happenings in the coming days for all the grand openings. So, in the meantime, have a magical week. Goodbye.
There's a great big beautiful tomorrow. Just a dream of